topic I've been asked to speak about is the relevance to illicit flow of funds from Africa when you're talking about BEPS. What I'm going to tell you is that there are actually two dimensions to it. We have illicit flow within Africa, it's still illicit, and we have illicit flow from Africa. But whichever way you look at it, we have to start addressing these issues as a matter of urgency. Before I go into it, the Global Financial Integrity carried out a survey, and they looked at a period of about 10 years to try and estimate the quantum, the amount of illicit flow out of Africa to the rest of the world. And they came up with a very revealing outcome. What they did was to look at different regions of the world, focusing on developing economies. And they put sub-Saharan Africa together as one region. We have Asia, we have developing Europe, we have Middle East and North Africa, that's MENA. And then we have Western Hemisphere. And then we have all developing economies combined. Now, what you would see from there is that in absolute terms, Asia leads the world. You see there, for about 10 years, they had about $2.6 trillion. Africa, about $528 billion. But if you look at that relatively, in terms of what is the size of the economy of sub-Saharan Africa, compared to the size of the economy of Asia, you see that relatively, Africa is actually leading the way in percentage terms. We then looked at the top 10 countries worldwide. And unfortunately, Nigeria and South Africa made the top 10. Even though these are smaller economies than some of the other economies that you have there on the list. Just look at Nigeria, for instance. Over this 10-year period, illicit flow of funds out of Nigeria was well over $157 billion. Annually, the average is $15.7 billion. You know what that means? That is actually more than 60% of our national budget. Imagine losing about 60% of your federal government budget every single year to illicit flow. Where do we get the money to construct roads, to pay for our civil servants? Many states now are still owing months of salaries. So it's not difficult to explain. And as a matter of fact, the impact is not limited to the money that we're losing. It's also the implication for our economy that we had that money kept in Nigeria. $157 billion, if it didn't go out of Nigeria, that would be money to create employment, to develop infrastructure, to provide soft infrastructure, to improve education, and the list goes on and on and on like that. So this is a national, regional emergency that we have to deal with. So, like I said earlier on, Sub-Saharan Africa is one of the regions where there's a lot of illicit flow. Now, relatively, Africa accounts for about 8%, that's Sub-Saharan Africa, accounts for about 8% of the world's illicit flow, even though, in terms of economic size, we only account for 2% of the world. You know, 2% of the world, but 8% of illicit flow. Which means relatively, we are four times worse than the rest of the world. Now, there are two sub-Saharan African countries, like I told you earlier on, and that's Nigeria and South Africa. On the average, we lose about 5.5% of our GDP in sub-Saharan Africa to illicit flow. That's bigger than the size of the manufacturing sector in Africa. And about 68.2% of the illicit flow is attributable to mispricing for tax purposes. So which means the balance will be corruption, you know, trafficking, and the rest of it. So technically, our biggest problem does not even look like corruption anymore. Suddenly, it's becoming a tax problem. people are now manipulating their affairs to shift our tax base, move money around so that they do not pay the right amount of tax. I have to say, though, that sometimes the motivation is not only tax. Tax might just be a key component of that decision and structuring. So our agenda today will be to, first and foremost, look at what is illicit financial flow, and then look at it in the context of Africa, and then what is the relevance of the OECD base erosion and profit shifting project, and then I will share with you my concluding thoughts. So what are illicit financial flows? I thought it would be good to refer to authorities on this subject. And one of that will be the report by the High-Level Panel on Illicit Financial Flow from Africa that was published in 2015, just about 2 years ago. And they simply define illicit financial flow as money illegally earned, illegally transferred, or illegally used, okay? But while I was doing my own analysis, I came to a conclusion that if you limit it to illegality alone, you don't capture everything. Because when you look at BEPS, for example, in most cases, it's not that the shifting of tax base is illegal. No, they're not violating the laws. They're just manipulating it. But that manipulation is done with bad intent. It's not done in good faith. You have a company that is selling to people in the UK, for example, but they are recording the sales somewhere else, in the Panamas, Bermuda, Virgin Islands. How can you have customers in Nigeria and the sales is recorded somewhere else? That's bad faith. It could be that you are taking advantage of existing laws or the lack of laws. You could explore loopholes, but whatever that is, it has to be addressed. So the above definition does not, however, properly address illicit financial flow to do with tax avoidance schemes where the law is simply manipulated. The main intent and purpose of illicit financial flow could be tax, it could be criminal, it could be because you don't want to be prosecuted, it could be just that money has been stolen and you don't want people to know about it. The whole world is now paying attention to BEPS. Typically, you have illicit financial flow is aided by laundering proceeds of crime. We have people who deal in human beings, human trafficking. We have proceeds of corruption. We have abuse of power. It's the reason why people will steal money or use government influence and power they have to award contracts to themselves, even when they can't deliver, and then they repatriate the money out of the country. Then you have market and regulatory imperfections leading to abuse. Whereas, for example, someone who has so much knowledge can come to Nigeria where we have limited knowledge about a particular sector and make us sign an agreement with them such that that agreement is not in the favor of Nigeria, but we don't know it. And of course, tax abuse. So, if you look at it very well, you find that illicit financial trading or financial flow is mostly boiled down to trade mispricing, especially for Africa. For the rest of the world, it's different from different continent to another. But for Africa, the biggest one is trade mispricing. Now, in Africa, if you look at the different combinations and factors leading to illicit financial flow, you see abusive transfer pricing. So this is where you actually do your transfer pricing. You have the documentation, you have the analysis. But you know, for experts in transfer pricing, they know this very well. Transfer pricing is not a precise science. It's not something where you say, here is the point, I got it, and the answer is 10 naira. No, transfer pricing is always a range. It will tell you between 7 naira and 12 naira is arm's length. So somebody then decides, you know, that's a very wide range. So which means, if ordinarily I should have gone for 8 naira, but I want to misprice, I'll take it to the close to the end of it. So what I've done is, even though I have my transfer pricing done, I have actually manipulated it. Then you have trade misinvoicing. So this is where either the thing never occurred, you just invoice. and you say we're providing support from Europe, which support were you providing? We can figure it out, but we want to invoice first. And then you have use of unequal contracts. So one of the issues I've seen in my career as a tax practitioner is that African countries do not have sufficient capacity to enter into good contracts on behalf of the continent. If you sit down today and you want to negotiate a double tax treaty with the US government, it will be, in my view, it will be just inviting troubles. The way those guys take those things is very seriously. They don't just send anybody just because they have a title as the head of this and that. They are people who have been trained not only in the technical content they are discussing, but also in negotiation skills. Do you know that if you are the best tax person in the world, but you are weak in negotiation, you end up signing a bad treaty for your country? Because it's not everything about it that is to do with technical ability or technical knowledge. So it's a combination of factors. So people are deliberately trained, exposed over time to negotiate on behalf of their country. One bad contract that you sign for Nigeria can lead us into losing billions of dollars. So these are things that before now we're taking for granted, but we can no longer afford to take these issues for granted. So unequal contract is a significant issue we have to pay attention to. This is when on your own, you signed away your rights, with or without knowing it. Then we have other BEPS activities like treaty abuse. So the transaction is between Nigeria and let's say, you know, and even France, we have a DTA with them. Let's say it's between Nigeria and the US. And then you now create some intermediate holding companies in different countries all the way just to be able to get benefit of double tax treaty. That's an abuse. Because if the intention is for America to trade with Nigeria, why do you juxtapose different entities in different countries between that transaction? Misinvoicing of services and intangibles. So every time you buy a bottle of Coca-Cola and you are drinking it, somebody is getting a royalty because what you are drinking is called Coca-Cola. Right, so that's legitimate because some guys invested in it. I'll do the same thing too if I have a brand that everybody likes, like that. Because the fact is, if I start my own business today and I want to start producing drinks like Coca-Cola, so let's even take Zobo. I don't know whether Zobo is still very common. It used to be common before. If somebody comes today and they say Zobo is better than Coke, and they can demonstrate it scientifically, their scientific analysis will mean almost nothing. Because when you get there in the market, people trust the brand Coca-Cola, and they'll buy it without any questions. Whereas if you carry Zobo to some places, even in Nigeria, they'll say, what is this Zobo serve? Somebody is rotating the bottle to see whether there's NAFDAC number, right? So the value of the brand means that the person who developed the brand is entitled to something, but the science and the complex issue is exactly how much is that person entitled to. That can be very difficult to figure out. And therefore, people then use intangibles and services to misprice and extract money out of different economies, including developing countries like Africa. We have misinvoicing to do with imports and exports. Today, our customs service in Nigeria collects under 1 trillion naira. That's a national embarrassment. We say Nigeria is heavily import dependent, and then we are not collecting import duty. How do you reconcile it? South Africa is a smaller economy. They collect from import duties over $35 billion. So and here we are, if you calculate our own, it's barely 3, so almost 10 times. Now, it's either we are deceiving ourselves that we are import dependent, or we are truly import dependent, but we are not declaring it. Something is wrong somewhere. Statistically, the average import to GDP ratio for Nigeria is 12.3%. So which means we tend to import about 12.3% of our GDP. China produces for the whole world. Even when you go to America, you see manufactured in China. Do you know that China imports 22% of their GDP? America imports 19% of their GDP. Many of the African countries import more than 20%. So here is the thing. Statistically, import is not our problem. But the reason why I struggle with that data is because if I reconcile it with the money we make from import duties and VAT on import, I can come to a conclusion, and that conclusion is a lot of import is underdeclared or not declared at all. That's the only way to explain it. They said they were closing the land border for import of cars, and people were complaining. I said, so why should you complain? Why should it matter where the car is coming from? Is it not just to enter inside Nigeria that is a problem? Plus, why would any human being on earth import a car that is meant for destination Nigeria? Import it, you know, they don't manufacture cars in Benin Republic. Do you agree? At least to my knowledge. So which means all the cars are first and foremost imported to a neighboring country and then imported into Nigeria. Logically, it doesn't make sense, right? It means more time, even if it's only ₦1 you pay to clear it in Benin Republic first. It means an extra ₦1. The question is, why don't you just import directly to Nigeria? The answers are very simple. It's because under declaration, non-declaration, non-payment of taxes. We can easily fund Nigeria's national budget from import duties alone if we get it right. So part of this illicit flow is misinvoicing of imports and exports. So we under-declare import and we over-invoice export. You know why? Export incentives. So government gets beaten both sides. And then people turn around and say the roads are bad. Why won't roads be bad? Of all the factors identified here, it's only one that is outside the purview of tax. Even that, tax can still play a role, and that is money laundering. And here is Africa, and that's the drain pipe. It's almost dried because everything that we should keep in Africa for us to flourish is flowing out of the continent. Due to bad governance, corruption, and weak institutions, plus, added on top of that, poor regulatory structures, double taxation agreements, tax incentives and waivers, then we have secrecy and poor data quality. I've always said that today, if I want to increase, and it's good that we have the FRSA, if I want to increase the number of individuals paying taxes, so a lot of work has been done to increase it from about, in fact, we didn't even know how many we had before, right? It was recently that JTB now told us 10 million people paying taxes in the whole of Nigeria. Now it's increased to about 14 million. Remarkable improvement, but that's still 14 million. In a country of almost 200 million people, people between the ages of 18 and 60, where you should have your active workforce, well over 80 million. Why is there only 14 million in the tax net? Now, if you look at data we already have, you can increase that number significantly. Start with INEC. You know INEC, you know what it means? Everybody worked there and said, without saying it, that I'm an adult, isn't it? Whether the person is now truly an adult or not, is none of my problem. He had presented him or herself as an adult of voting age. INEC has more than 37 million people. They've captured them, both visual, biometric, everything. What do I need? Just transfer the entire record. And you know the state where they are actually. The next day, I can guarantee you almost 99%, if not 100%, of everybody who has a register with INEC has a register with NCC for their mobile phone. Over more than 120 million unique phone registrations in Nigeria. I'll get the data the following day. I don't ask them to come and register. I register them by default. You just get an SMS. You have been registered for tax. Your tax number is this. We notice you have never paid any tax before. I hereby give you 30 days to regularize your tax payments. I can move it from 14 million to about 40 million almost immediately. So data quality is important. Even look at BVN. BVN, the CBN has got over 30, as of 2 days ago I read it, over 30 million BVN. You know, BVN is not duplicated. Only one BVN is counted, even if you have 10 accounts. If you take the number of companies in Nigeria, let's even assume that every single company in Nigeria has an account. The number of companies in Nigeria are less than 2 million, which means individuals who have bank accounts are more than 30 million individuals. How come they are not registered for personal income tax? So these are raw data we have, and we are not even using them yet. So what's the relevance of the OECD BEPS action plan to illicit flow? So there are 15 action points. I won't bore you with all of them, but they deal with different areas of base erosion and profit shifting. That if you address all of them, the problem will not go away 100%, but at least you deal with more than 80% of the problems. Out of the 15.7 billion that we lose annually in Nigeria alone, I'm not even talking about ECOWAS or Sub-Saharan Africa. For Sub-Saharan Africa, it's more than $60 billion. If you can't get all of that, if you get 80%, we will not be talking about budget deficit today, as we are discussing it in many of the countries in the region. So one of that, of the action plan that can help us address illicit flow of fund, is interest deductibility rule, and that's action number 4. So at the moment, it's easy for me to design different financial instruments and collect interest even when that money was not even needed in the first place. And bear in mind that it's not in all cases that the instrument will be called a loan on which you pay an interest. We can call it any other name, but the substance will be that interest is being paid on a loan. And you know that interest is tax deductible. So the attraction is I'd rather get interest than wait for dividend, because before I get my dividend, government would have collected 32% plus 10% withholding tax. I want to be able to keep that to myself. I know on interest, you get withholding tax, but you know the sweetener is you can even structure it so that you don't pay withholding tax at all under this foreign loan. You know some of the things we have in our laws, we put them there when Mungo Park was around. In those days, the economy scenario and situation for Nigeria are very different from today. But we have been very lazy as a people, not looking at our tax law every single year. That's what they do in every country. I was in South Africa just last week, and the minister was going to read the budget. Come and see the way everybody, the whole economy stood still because everybody wanted to listen to government. As they were reading the budget, they increased the topmost rate for personal income tax from about 41 or 42% to 45%. And they can immediately tell the people of South Africa how many South Africans will be captured by that. They already know. They say it was about 103,000 people. And they immediately quantified how much money they will make from that. That's the quality of data that they have. Another one is harmful tax practices. So this is where, for example, you arrange your affairs in a way that you take advantage of the tax system, including the use of intellectual property, lack of transparency and secrecy, as well as manipulating incentives. All of these things can also be addressed by looking at BEPS. Review will help us combat the abuse of incentives in Africa, including generous tax holidays that enable illicit financial flows. There's so many investors that didn't even know about incentive before they got into Nigeria. It was after they had arrived. We say, by the way, you know there is pioneer status. By the way, you know there. I say, ah, really? Are you sure? And then on top of that, they now collected those incentives. We have not taken a step back to say how relevant are these incentives. Should they still be in this current format, or should we rejig them? Chances are that if something was put in place over 10 years ago, it's almost certain it will not be completely relevant again today. Things evolve so fast, so the tax laws and changes must evolve even faster. Otherwise, we'll be playing catch-up game, and that's very expensive. Then we have artificial avoidance of permanent establishment status. We have written the rules. If you do this, and you do this, and you do this, there will be permanent establishment. When there's permanent establishment, you have to pay income tax. You say, okay. But you say, you know what? But that permanent establishment rule excludes this one, and this one. You know, that's ridiculous. What you have just done, you are telling the guy, even though what you want to do is you want to make sales in Nigeria, but try and arrange it such that it falls under the exclusions so that I can artificially avoid permanent establishment. Once I've avoided permanent establishment, I don't pay income tax. It is not me that wrote the rules. It is the government of Nigeria. So why should I be more concerned as an investor, whether I'm foreign or not, more than the government? So people can artificially avoid permanent establishment. There's some terminologies now that the OECD have introduced, like significant people function. We have some countries where that's where the company is legally, but they don't even have a single employee. You see a company that is making billions of dollars in revenue, not a single staff. What kind of company is that? And then the people who are doing the work are in a different country, and the revenue is not being reported or not reported appropriately in that other country. We have mandatory disclosure rule. So here's the thing about disclosure. The fact that everybody, even dictators, are afraid of public opinion, it means that when you ask people to disclose, it's a deterrent. It's a deterrent. The fact that they know the information will be revealed to the public or to authorities, people are more careful. The information getting into the public space is a deterrent. The same thing is true for tax and tax arrangement, including illicit flows. The United States of America has one of the most complex and difficult tax systems in the world, but they are not begging anybody to come. They're big, so they're too big to be ignored. And their rule is, if you like, leave America and go and live abroad for 50 years. You'd never break your tie with America. You must continue to file returns, and if there's balance of tax to pay, you must pay. But many Americans were outside of America, and they were not reporting their income. So America did not know and could not collect tax from them. They suddenly realized they were losing more than $100 billion every single year. Because they are American and they are strong, they now pass a law and ask the whole world to comply on their behalf. FATCA, how can you be doing that? You made law. Are we America? Are we not Nigeria? They say, all of you, you must comply on our behalf. Report Americans to us and people who have our green passports. Say, what if we don't report? Yeah, that's okay. If you don't report, any flow that passes through America in dollars, we hold 30% of it. Nigeria was just bragging. America should go to hell. Nigerian banks said, we cannot ask them to go to hell. Because the Nigerian banks know the implication for them. Unless you want to be a community bank, you cannot do banking without America. Even if you don't have customer in America, you must use US dollars. So today, Nigeria is complying. But the thing is, we are only going through the pain of compliance. We are not getting the benefits. Because we haven't officially signed an agreement with the US, they are not reciprocating it. So we are sending, what you normally do under FATCA is you have different levels of agreement such that as you send information to the US, US will send you information as well. So we need to tidy up all those loose ends so that we can gain the benefit of different initiatives around the world on disclosure rules. So there's common reporting standard, for example. And I looked at the recent one. Nigeria hasn't signed. So what they are doing now is if you have accounts abroad, banks are writing to their customers. You must sign an undertaking, an agreement, that they're going to send your information without your knowledge automatically to the country where you are from. If you refuse to sign, they close your account and return your money to you. Okay? So what that means is Nigeria can easily sign up and be waiting to get information on people who have millions of, you know, the millions in Nigeria is small. Those millions of dollars we are seeing in Nigeria that people are revealing because of whistleblowing. It's small compared to the illicit. You know, this illicit flow is not even complete. They said it's 15.7 billion. Imagine the one that hasn't been reported. Significant, huge. So, and then we have the transfer pricing documentation and country by country reporting action number 13. that requires that you should look at master files, local files, and country by country reports. And the whole essence is, if a multinational operates in 120 countries and they prepare their group accounts, you're likely to see revenue is $20 billion, tax is $5 billion. It looks okay, you pay $5 billion out of 20. But what you haven't seen is that when they break it down into components, there are some countries where they've made hundreds of millions of dollars and pay little or nothing in taxes. So the idea is, let's be transparent and let's be honest. If you have nothing to hide, why are you hiding in the first place? So let's tell us. These are our group accounts. It's made up of activities in 120 countries. And each of those 120 countries, here is our revenue, expenses, profit, and tax. I think that's the starting point for us to start having conversation with those companies. So, to try and conclude now, you see that lack of transparency and secrecy is a major hindrance for us to solve some of the problems we are facing, including illicit flow. But my point is, for many of the countries in Africa and in ECOWAS, our problem is not just that there's secrecy, is that we haven't even started processing the data we have. Today, the laws in Nigeria allow the tax man to access your information that you have in a bank. There's banking secrecy, but then there's an overriding consideration for the tax man. So why don't I get your banking data and use that to figure out whether you've paid the right amount of tax? When people know that you have intelligence, even the hardest person on earth will be nervous and be afraid. When you write to someone and you say, we think that your tax is about 50 million, best of judgment, we think you should come and pay. And the guy is wondering, what's wrong with this guy? Where did you see 50 million? You say, life is difficult for me. All those things that you see that I'm using, I'm just borrowing. In fact, I'm owing the bank now. So we now start debating it. But imagine that you've done your research and you have intelligence. And you know the money they have in their bank account. You know their expenditure pattern. You know when they traveled with the family and they flew business class with five. Dad, mom, and three kids, first class. That one alone, if I do the assessment on it for 1 year, you know what it will be. So my closing thoughts. These BEPS will not solve all the problems in the world. There's one I was thinking about as I was preparing these materials. I talked about MMM. You know MMM, isn't it? MMM, you know people lost plenty of money from this thing. I don't know how somebody can be so gullible. They say, bring money. You collect 30%, you follow there. What kind of business is that? You know, you now collect money. You know, CBN now warned. I said, don't do MMM, it's not good. Nigerians did a video. That video, you should look for it on YouTube. Very laughable. They said, leave us alone, no. CBN is warning them not to do MMM. They said, CBN does not want them to progress. They now did a video to say, leave us alone. It was 1 month after that that the thing crashed. Somebody now said, nobody is even talking about MMM again. Their money is stuck. But then I was thinking about it. I said, why don't you even tax them? People who collected 30%. You know, for tax purposes, it's not whether what you have done is moral. Even if it's illegal, it's irrelevant. First and foremost, come and pay the tax first. We can now discuss where you even got the money from. So even MMM is liable to tax. And the guys who even set up the MMM, you know they are not Nigerians. And they had made some money and they didn't pay tax and they just went like that. When life was becoming difficult for them, they said they won't spend currency anymore because CBN is frustrating them. They will spend cryptocurrency. It's virtual currency. You know the way the world is going now, bitcoins, is they want to take everything off the radar of the regulators. And the way to address this thing, CBN now came out and said, we don't like bitcoins, don't use it. See, the way to deal with it is not to say you don't like it. The way to deal with it is to try and understand it, you regulate it, and be a step ahead. This thing happens every time. When we don't understand things, we withdraw from it. When the thing is now taking over the whole world, hey, what are they even talking about? Transfer pricing was started in 1994 by America. Nobody took them seriously. Today, that's number one issue in the world. America started FATCA. We are saying we are not signing. We have not signed, though. A few years back, they say, that practical thing, if only we had signed, somebody would now come and do a presentation like this and tell us how much money we should have made. We can prevent it now. We should not always be doing crisis management. So, the impact and magnitude of illicit financial flow from Africa is greater than typically reported due to poor data and huge black economy. Generally, abusive transfer pricing and trade misinvoicing constitute the most prominent means of illicit financial flow from Africa. I even think that, even though I said the largest chunk of it is not corruption, we can even use tax to address even corruption itself. Because when people make money, they like to spend it. Money is meaningless when you don't spend. You either spend or you keep. Both spending and keeping of money can be tracked, especially in this modern age. Lack of information and capacity limitation of government agencies in Africa allows for greater base erosion and profit shifting. My recommendation is that WAUTI, in conjunction with WATAF, that's West African Tax Administration Forum, in conjunction with ECOWAS, should build a joint task force of experts who not only study all these initiatives, they will develop people who know how to negotiate on behalf of West Africa, such that when you are signing, you are just not signing and taking pictures. You know what you are signing. And you know how to domesticate it. When it does not favor you, you know how to negotiate. We must begin to invest in this kind of initiatives. The OECD BEPS project provides a good platform for African countries to mitigate the impact of IFFs from the continent, but more will be needed to fix the problem holistically. It's not only BEPS that will help us solve the problem, but BEPS is going to help us significantly. So to close, I like this quote by Her Excellency, the President of Liberia, Ellen Johnson Sirleaf. She said, and I quote, that Africa is actually not poor, it's only just poorly managed. And I agree with her 100%. We're not poor, we're just managing our economies in a very bad manner. Thank you very much for paying attention to me.